Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for coming today. I'm Casey Greenleaf. I'm a campaign and advocacy fellow for the Environmental League of Massachusetts. And ELM is a 121-year-old environmental advocacy organization based on Beacon Hill. We've been advocating for Massachusetts to lead the nation in responsible environmental policy since 1898. We've long been a convener on environmental issues, and we're proud to continue on in this long tradition in this new digital way. So I'm delighted to welcome today our over 300 registrants joining us by Zoom, and also those of you who are watching this today on Facebook Live. You all include policymakers, business people, environmental advocates, social justice leaders, parents, grandparents, teachers, and students. I hope you and your families are safe and that you're finding ways to get outside and connect with nature and each other during this unprecedented time. So I want to welcome you to this fifth edition of ELM's new weekly webinar series. It's the fifth of 10 sessions, which will run through June 10th. We've endeavored to make these sessions timely, thought-provoking, and forward-thinking. And if there's any topics that you would like us to cover on a future webinar, please, you can suggest them today in the Q&A box below. I'd like to extend my thanks to Biogen, whose generous support makes this series possible. Over the past 4 weeks, we've heard about the profound interconnections between climate change and human health, how the most vulnerable among us are bearing the brunt of those impacts, how our federal policymakers are approaching a stimulus that would benefit our goals, and how the coverage of climate change in the media has evolved over the years. We've seen how public policy plays the central role in determining how we manage the two crises of COVID-19 and climate change. So today, we're joined by Seven Flores, one of the coordinators for the Boston Hub of the Sunrise Movement, one of the largest and most active hubs in the country. The youth climate movement has seen an absolute explosion of activity over the last couple of years, and the way it has brought the climate crisis to national attention is truly remarkable. Here at ELM, we are particularly grateful to youth activists for shaping the policy conversation and expanding the scope of what might be possible for the environmental community to achieve. Today, Seven will introduce Sunrise, its mission, discuss the recent successes and journey of youth climate activism, and also dive into how going remote has tested and changed how the youth climate movement organizes. For the next hour, you can expect about 15 minutes of remarks from Seven, 20 minutes of discussion with questions from the ELM team and those questions submitted in advance from registrants, 20 minutes of live Q&A from you, our audience. And you can make sure that if anything comes to mind throughout the webinar, you can click below again on that Q&A button to submit a question or upvote questions from others that might resonate with you. As the webinar continues, the ELM team will consolidate those topics and then Seven and I will respond. And as I mentioned, this event is being broadcast on Facebook Live, and we're also recording these sessions, which will be available on ELM's YouTube page. So then you can share beyond those who are able to attend live today. So without any further ado, I'm extremely pleased to introduce to you all Seven Flores. Seven is originally from Mexico, but lived most of his life in South Texas, where he first encountered political work. He has long been involved and worked with environmental, immigration, and political campaigns, having spent time as an advocacy fellow for Move Texas, worked for Teach for America, and served as the political outreach director for Beto O'Rourke's 2018 senatorial campaign. Seven currently teaches science and math to third graders in Dorchester, acts as the hub coordinator for the Sunrise Movement in Boston, is a part of the Massachusetts Youth Climate Coalition, which includes multiple youth climate organizations such as Boston Climate Strike, Boston Student Advisory Council, Fridays for Future, Our Climate, and the Massachusetts Climate Education Organization. And on top of all of that, he is pursuing a master's in education at Boston University. In his studies, he's focused on education, environmental justice, politics, and empowering people during the SARS-CoV-19 epidemic. So again, without any further ado, please take it away, Seven.
Thank you, Casey, everyone who's watching us, and to the Environmental League of Massachusetts for hosting these great seminars that I have had the pleasure of watching, and for everything you have done for over a century. I know that previously the topics of public health, environmental justice, public policy, and the evolution of journalism have been touched on. And today I will connect those issues while discussing youth climate activism during this crisis. As Casey just mentioned, my name is Seven, and yes, Seven is spelled just like the number. And for almost 10 years, I have been involved in immigration, education, and environmental policy, whether it is through community outreach or working on campaigns. I first began getting involved in these issues because I experienced how the actions or lack of actions from our representatives affected me as someone who lived on the southern border in Laredo next to Rio Grande, which is a river that millions of people depend on. And unfortunately, as when I was younger, I saw it filled with plastic, and also how it affected me as an undocumented person and later a DACA recipient when I was younger. And today, more than ever, I continue being involved in these issues because I clearly see the intersectionality between immigration and environmental issues. As previously mentioned also, I am currently a hub coordinator for Sunrise Boston. Nationwide, Sunrise is an organization, an ever-growing group of young people whose goal is to make climate change an urgent priority across America and the corrupting influence of fossil fuel executives in politics and elect leaders who stand up for the health and well-being of all people. Here in Massachusetts, Sunrise Boston has carried on the same goals, along with the Coalition of Mike, which once again stands for the Coalition of Massachusetts Youth Climate, which consists of youth fighting to change the public narrative, influence policy, improve environmental science curriculum across Massachusetts schools, empowering young people, and of course, elect leaders who have these same values across Massachusetts. And to regress a little bit, back in 2017, a lot of young people were very disappointed with our representatives and the media. We saw, for example, how in the presidential debates of 2016, climate change was hardly touched upon, how many leaders did not take climate policy seriously, and how ultimately this was reflected at the end of the 2016 election results. That was a very hard year for us, for the climate movement, and for many other reasons. However, we decided to take action more than ever. And shortly after, organizations such as Sunrise Boston began. And after multiple efforts in the past 3 years, I am so happy to say that major shift has occurred on how the media covers climate change, as it was also previously mentioned in the previous seminar. And we have also been seeing an increase in bills and resolutions, such as the Green New Deal, and the increase of time that was given on the primary debates in the recent months, which was definitely a huge difference between 2016. And I say with much confidence that all this happened because our strategy is based on putting people's stories first and empowering communities that are mostly affected by climate change. Unfortunately, in the past, the face of climate activism was usually carried on by upper class individuals who were not mostly affected by climate change, such as celebrities, or in some cases, scientists who would struggle on connecting the scientific jargon and data into people's lives to create a more impactful message. We have also been doing this by direct actions to our representatives in the past years, and by endorsing and volunteering to multiple local and state campaigns. I am proud to say that last year, out of the 8 candidates that we endorsed locally in Boston, in the greater Boston area, out of the 8 that we endorsed, 7 of them were able to get elected. And by all means, we plan to continue on doing that in this critical year of 2020. And I can say that our momentum just keeps on growing. And I want to invite everyone to join us, because I know that we can definitely do this together and have a better, more green and just world for everyone. Now, I want to shift and talk about the current challenge that COVID-19 has dealt to the climate youth activist movement. This year we were very excited about so many goals and projects that we had been working on. Some of us were even working on this year's Earth Day since the day after the previous Earth Day. Back in February, we started having conversations about how COVID-19 could affect our plans for Earth Day and many other projects. We didn't know if we would have to postpone or perhaps even cancel all of our efforts. Before long, as many of us experienced, things moved so quickly. And some of us were not even thinking about climate activism because we were so concerned about families, some of us about rent, some of us about losing our jobs. It was a very difficult time. It was definitely very sad for all the youth climate groups, but eventually, as we saw how the same communities that were also mostly affected by climate change were also being affected by COVID-19, we were reminded of our values, those values of all these organizations that talked about how primarily communities of color, low-income communities, are the most affected by climate change, just as it is today with COVID-19. It was and still is very painful to see how ill-prepared we all are for this, and it is very heartbreaking and upsetting to realize that every time a crisis, whether it is a pandemic or a climate catastrophe, that primarily communities of color and low-income families are going to be affected the most if we don't take action and change the way our society is. It shouldn't take something like a pandemic for us to finally realize that what youth climate organizations and other advocates have been saying is that certain communities are going to be most affected. And it is sad to say once again that if we don't take action, we don't change the way things are, these same communities are going to be affected. It is ridiculous how in a matter of weeks, these communities can lose their jobs, be afraid that they might not be able to pay rent. And in some cases, even see some family members suffering from the sickness of COVID-19. So because of this, we decided to take action. Also, I want to say that as a teacher, even before social distancing started and schools began to close, I was also very concerned about a lot of my students. I knew that some of my students might not have easy access to the internet or technology, and that also made it even more personal to me and made me realize that just like before COVID-19, certain students, certain backgrounds are mostly affected by crisis. And this just emphasized it for me even more that I have to take action and I want other people to do the same. And however, after all of this, thanks to the creativity of a lot of our members and just how passionate we are, we took action. And for example, in this couple of weeks back during Earth Day, we decided to have a virtual Earth Week. And yes, although we could not be out there doing demonstrations or being at this, for example, at the state house, we got very creative and we had multiple educational webinars in where we talked about climate activism, how to get involved. And we also made a lot of efforts to do outreach to and put pressure into our representatives to further emphasize how this crisis is affecting certain communities the most and that we need to take action. And we also thought about how a lot of us are struggling, and beyond climate activism, we also use our platforms to get together with a lot of young people and other people to talk about these challenges and how difficult it is to reflect on this and to just tell each other that we're there for each other and that we'll eventually overcome this. And I know that we're gonna be more powerful than ever. After experiencing this, we have learned different strategies on how to reach out virtually, and we plan to use these things that we learned after the COVID-19 crisis to do even further outreach in the Boston area in Massachusetts. Some of the campaigns that we have been recently decided on, for example, one priority campaign is the mutual aid campaign. And what we're doing is that we're using our platform to reach out to communities and to organizations that are mostly feeling affected by this, whether it is a food bank or helping families not lose their houses or their apartments. That is something that Sunrise is doing. And we want other organizations or people that may be watching us to please let us know about how we can help during this crisis. Also, we're emphasizing as well how intersectionality of climate and other issues in this crisis. And one last thing that I want to mention is that, emphasize actually, is that if there's something that I want people to learn from the things that I just mentioned, is that it shouldn't once again take this crisis for us to realize that certain communities are going to be affected every time there is a crisis. It is very heartbreaking for me to know once again that if we don't do anything about this, that the next time there's a crisis, those same people are going to be affected the most. And I want us to please join us and support us. There will later be sent out a link with all the organizations that we're working with and how you can support. Thank you so much. And I am happy to answer any questions that the public has. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Seven. I myself am a member of Sunrise Boston, and it's humbling to hear back all the work that the youth climate movement has accomplished over the past few years, as well as the projects that Sunrise is managing to keep up right now. Also, you and I, we already know each other, but I'm always so happy and also, again, humbled to hear more about what brings each person into this work. And I just want to thank you for your leadership during this time. It's very inspiring. So now we're going to transition into some of the questions that were submitted in advance during registration, and also some of the questions that were prepared by us at ELM. And just as a reminder to all of you listening out there, the last 15 minutes of this webinar, those are going to be reserved for questions sent in that Q&A box below. So please don't be shy about submitting, and we want to see all of your questions as we move through. So, Seven, in light of remaining empowered and inspired, I know and we all feel that the fight we're engaged in against climate change is even more insurmountable than usual in this new reality. So I'm curious how you and the youth climate community are remaining empowered and inspired.
Yeah. So I think it goes back to one of the things that I was just mentioning, is that although this is definitely very difficult in many levels to all of us and all the youth that is involved in climate activism, this challenge is also being a test for us and a reminder of things that we have been talking about in the past, that if there's a crisis, certain communities are going to be the most affected by. We have also seen like some data saying how the areas in which there was the most pollution, for example, the mortality rate increases for the people in those communities, because of course pollution can affect lungs, for example, which makes it even more difficult to overcome an infection of COVID-19. And yeah, so all of that is just reminding us of stay involved and reminding us of our values. And that is why, despite all difficulties, we continue to be inspired in this time. And also, of course, I happen to be part of amazing organizations, a lot of people that are very inspiring and who also motivate me to continue being involved.
Yeah, that's awesome. I feel like all of us are seeing in this time like the power of our communities and the power of the people around us to keep us inspired and motivated. I felt that myself so many times. In sort of a similar vein, we've got something going overhead here. In a similar vein, I know in my own work that it's hard enough just to stay motivated during one's paid job. So I'm curious for you what it's been like being a volunteer, and I know that you've spoken to the motivation of the community, but yeah, what's it like being a volunteer right now?
Yes, it is definitely, once again, very challenging. I'm a teacher at the moment as well, and that has also been a challenge to move from the classical way of teaching in the classroom to teaching third graders through Zoom. And however, as I talk to families, parents, and even some of my students, and they tell me about how they don't have a laptop, or how they only have one, how they struggle with the internet. Some parents tell me about how they're struggling with paying rent, paying bills. And even though that's also very overwhelming for me to hear on top of everything else, it just motivates me to continue doing my work and empowering other people, because I realize that the reason why these families and these communities are in these problems in the first place was because we never took proper action on properly representing those communities and properly supporting and having a plan for in times of crisis like this one.
Yeah. I also want to go back to something you said about, you know, the community, which is something that resonated with me so much. I know that as from my own involvement in the Sunrise Movement, I know that one of our core values is how we thrive and we're built upon the strength of our human connections and our relationships that we've built with one another and with our communities. I'm curious how Sunrise has drawn upon, maintained, or maybe even grown the power of its community over this time.
Yes, so as I mentioned, beyond virtual climate activism, we have also used our platform to invite our members and also other people who have never been involved in any type of climate activism or activism in general to come to our events. For example, just this past Friday, we just had our first virtual hub meeting, and we had over 80 persons who were in that meeting. A lot of them were people who had never been involved with us. And we talk about regular things about how we're doing, what we can do to support each other, even just activities such as having breakfast together on a Sunday, or talk about books that we're reading. Stuff like that has really helped a lot of us, like staying connected, build stronger relationships between us and people who we just met. And also a lot of people have come to us who feel that they don't have the power to make a change and come to us and we talk to them about that there's definitely things that we can do, as we showed 2 weeks ago during Virtual Earth Week, and how after all of this, we are sure that we're going to be even more powerful than ever to make the change we want during this year that, once again, it's so critical for many political and other contemporary issues.
Yeah, I loved what you said about us having breakfast together. I've had some funny meetings that are taking place over dinner periods, and so it's always been really wonderful to have that platform for, you know, getting asked about how you're doing. And yeah, I think it's really wonderful to have this opportunity to grow and strengthen our communities. So you mentioned some of the past webinars. So over these past weeks that ELM has been hosting these, we've seen more and more how differences, as you mentioned, in lived experience drastically influence how people are affected both by COVID-19 and the climate crisis. And to that point, could you talk a little bit about how your personal experiences shape your understanding of this crisis and the role that environmental activism plays in it?
Yes, definitely. So part of my identity is that I was previously an undocumented individual, and I'm currently a DACA recipient. And as I've continued being involved, I have just seen how a lot of issues are connected, like the intersectionality that I was talking about in the beginning. And I think about how that a lot of people might be put in the same situation that I was placed on as we see more climate change and how this is affecting, whether it is agricultural workers in Central America or people in India, through flooding, and how this could also put people in a position in which they might have to leave their homes for their life when they don't want to leave. And that has been something that has really shaped the way I see things. Also by further seeing by my first experience, my family and a lot of friends, how this COVID-19 crisis is affecting the people that I have been worried so much about, makes me see things more holistically. Just a couple of weeks, we were making decisions as an organization, and we put a further emphasis on the current crisis and how to be better prepared in the future. Also, as an immigrant, I have seen how. So we know that unfortunately, immigrant communities have always been some of the mostly affected by any type of issue. For example, at work, they tend to have a lot of harsh conditions, lack of healthcare, lack of rights. And now with COVID-19, that has unfortunately gotten even worse for a lot of these people. On top of all those harsh conditions, now you have this health crisis that is making life even more difficult for those communities.
Thank you so much for sharing. It's really important to hear that, I think, for all of us right now. This is sort of a question that I think is one of the ones that I've heard come up a couple times, just, you know, in my own movements throughout. And so in all sectors, right, when it comes to asking more of our governments, it seems now that the question of timeliness is on people's minds. So, you know, what would you say to people that might be saying that now is not the right time to be focusing on climate activism?
Yeah, thank you for asking that. I enjoy answering questions and statements that people usually say. And the first thing that I want to say is that is a valid point. I understand from the perspective of someone who might have lost their job, struggling to pay bills, doesn't know if his or her family are going to have a place to live on, to be thinking about a virtual activist action. So it is definitely a valid point. But something that I would tell that person, whoever asked that question, is that to think about why they are being the most affected by this in the first place, as opposed to other people. And to think again about how a lot of our local leaders, political leaders nationwide and statewide, have not taken proper action to properly prepare for things like this. And also how they have always have a lack of representation, how their voices are not heard, and that it is clear every day through bills that get passed in the US or the state. And I feel that by taking that into consideration, someone will realize that we do need to take action, even in this moment, because more than ever, it is more than clear that we have to make sure that this doesn't happen again, that we have to be the voices and tell representatives that this is affecting me, this is affecting us more than anyone else because of their lack of actions, because of their lack of representation, and for not listening to these communities for so long. So that is why I think that even though it's understandably very difficult to be involved in these times, that we still need to make an effort in whatever way we can.
Yeah, I think that's a really wonderful way of thinking about it, like the interconnectedness that you keep coming back to, and I think is something really helpful for me personally to latch onto in continuing on doing climate-related work, is that, you know, it's all connected, and we have to be thinking about the interconnectedness of everything. Shifting gears a little bit, I would love to talk about Earth Day. So I know that you had a virtual rally, the teach-ins that you mentioned, and I know that Ed Markey had a very big day, because on the same day that he was at the ELM webinar at noon, he went and then spoke at the Sunrise and Youth Climate Rally in the evening. So I'm just curious what the main takeaways were for you, and if the event changed anything about how Sunrise or youth climate activists are thinking about virtual strategies, or just generally the effectiveness of virtual activism as a whole.
Yeah, definitely. I can think of a couple of things. First, just like a teacher, I have become more tech savvy. I have better abilities to reach out to people, to be more effective, and realize that I can do, I'm like, with power of the internet, we can do amazing things as we try to accomplish our goals. And I also realize that all these things that we have learned are not just for these times. We can use them after post COVID-19 to become more effective and powerful activists, to shape policy and better represent all people. The second thing that I think about is going back to how difficult it was for me and a lot of youth climate activists to think about how for a second we thought that we were not gonna be able to do the things that we wanted, how things were so unclear, so emotionally challenging, but that despite all those challenges and we were able to accomplish so much, we have been able to stay active, we have been able to continue reaching out to new people, we have connected with other organizations, built stronger partnerships to help communities or each other. And I know that even though it is hard to see things positive right now, I know that these challenges have made us stronger as people, as activists, and that we're gonna use all those lessons that we learned after COVID-19. And I am very excited about the things that we're gonna do in the second half of 2020. Like I mentioned, this is such a critical year, and yeah.
We'll follow the advice of you teachers that will take these lessons and we'll apply them going forward. My mother's a teacher, so that particularly resonates with me. So this is a question that I'm seeing pop up in the Q&A box. So great job everyone for using the Q&A. So many people are interested in learning more about youth climate activism or getting involved themselves and seeing questions such as good resources for tweens, those between 9 and 12 years old who aren't quite teenagers yet. What are effective actions that young people can start taking to join the fight and be a part of these communities?
Yeah, so the first thing that I want to say to teens is that I'm delighted to say that I've already met middle school students, high school students who are heavily involved in this. There's also organizations, some of the ones that I previously mentioned, such as Boston Climate Strike, and that some of our members and some of their leaders in the organizations are people who are between 12, 17, and who are taking action and reminding our representatives that their lives, their futures are the ones that are going to be the most effective, right? So having those realizations, I would tell anyone who has a question to please reach out to Sunrise Boston, to Mike, and all those organizations, which I believe we will send a link and a follow-up, right, with all the organizations.
Yeah, either that or we can connect you. We'll give any follow-up questions. We'll make sure those get to you.
Yeah, and to continue, and please reach out to us. Currently at the moment, as I was mentioning, we are active. We're still having meetings, and I want to invite you to please reach out to me so that I can connect you with them. And I can assure you that you will learn better ways to stay connected with us, how to take action, and also build community with a lot of people who are probably feeling the same way about climate change.
It seems that there is absolutely no lack of opportunities for people to get involved. And I feel like some of the most inspiring people that I've seen in the movement are one 15-year-old comes to mind.
I think I know who you're talking about.
So I think this is the perfect opportunity for us to start moving into the audience Q&A, which has been coming in. So as you mentioned, there's lots of ways to be involved, but I wanna talk a little bit about the traditional environmental movement. What has this traditional environmental movement maybe missed that the youth has been able to fill in the gaps for? And How can we build the bridges between the traditional environmental advocates and youth environmental advocates?
Yeah, that's an amazing question. So I will start by emphasizing some of the things that I mentioned. So traditionally, I think the main problem was the outreach component. And what I mean by that is that traditionally we did not quite connect climate change and environmental issues to people, directly to people. I mentioned how even just a few years back, when I will hear someone talk about climate change, it was typically scientists, which are people that I admire a lot. But in many cases, not everyone was as charismatic as, let's say, Bill Nye. And you will just hear all this all this jargon, talk about all this terminology. And it was difficult for people to relate. And something that we know from like a lot of psychological studies is that when you can relate a topic through, for example, people stories, and that's going to be more effective, that's going to stick with people more. And ultimately, that's going to help people take action and be part of this movement. So that is one thing. So when how it has been different. Also, it hadn't quite been as diverse as it is. Today, we put a lot of emphasis on representing all people, and especially those most affected by this. In the past, the people who will mostly do the outreach were upper income people, celebrities, and they couldn't quite relate to someone who was actually being affected by these issues. And yeah, I think there was a second question to that. And did I answer the question?
Yeah, how can we better bridge the gaps?
Yeah, so I think that we definitely need to take more initiative on building partnerships with youth organizations and with other, in quote, more traditional organizations, climate. And I think we really need to attend each other's meetings, sit down and talk about how we can do that. And to more specifically answer the question, I think we have to be very critical of ourselves and like tell more older organizations about why in some areas they haven't been as effective as we could have hoped, and think about how we can change that. Those are definitely difficult conversations because we're talking about changing things quite a bit. But I think that if we get together and talk more about this and we're critical, that we can definitely build and the gaps between each other and work together, because I know in the end we all have the same goals.
Yeah. We sure do. And you know, just as you said, those most difficult conversations, usually the most important conversations for us to be having. And hopefully more webinars like this and more collaborations between groups like ELM and the youth climate movement, it'll get us where we need to go. So we have some more questions.
Yeah, happy to.
This is just sort of a specific question, but what are some of the specific requests that you are making to the representatives? That's what one person asked.
Yeah, so I will answer that at the federal level, and then I'll touch more on the local and state level. So right now at the federal level, there are some resolutions and bills who try to pass, and a lot of them revolve around the Green New Deal. And to be more specific, we want climate policy to have a stronger emphasis on people. And once again, I will repeat this again, and specifically to those being affected the most, we want our governments to be prepared for this type of crisis. We also want the government to not only accept that climate change is real, but also have a sense of urgency. And what I mean by that when it comes to legislation is that there's a lot of bills who are talking about 2040, 2050, and sometimes even more than that, to take significant action. And Maybe they can wait, but there's people in the US and outside the US that cannot wait. I met other people like from India, Mexico, even just here in New Orleans and Florida, who definitely cannot wait. Every year, hurricanes, for example, are becoming more severe, and that is affecting their lives, their livelihoods. Some people lose their homes because of that. That is so, we're definitely pushing for legislation to be more urgent and to tackle these challenges as soon as possible.
Yeah, I think you're spot on about the urgency of this crisis. And we've moved sort of past asking for people to accept that climate change is real because, you know, we're just past that now.
Oh yeah, and also now at the local, in local state level. And some of the things that we have been doing is we have been asking candidates to sign the Green New Deal pledge. And I'm happy to say that in 2019, we got close to 50 candidates to sign that. And although you could argue that's mostly symbolic, it is just so so inspiring how something that was seen as extreme or just too much is now becoming common sense to a lot of people. So we're asking local candidates to sign that and to think about climate when they're thinking about housing, when they're thinking about transportation, the local level, and because that also relates to climate change.
Yeah, and that symbolism that you're talking about is so important, I think. You know, just seeing these gestures and seeing this be accepted, I think, is part of, you know, what we've heard in past webinars is just like moving the needle. It's really important. So I want to go back to talking about, we touched on the bridging the gap between the traditional environmental movement and the youth movement. And I had one person ask about older generations. How is Sunrise Boston engaging with older generations? And what are further specific actions that those of us in older generations can take to support Sunrise Boston?
Yeah, so to answer that question, I will say what we're doing. And I would also say what older generations are doing even today to support us. So first I wanna say that we are critical about regenerations and about some lack of efforts that have been in the past, to be very bold with that, especially with organizations. But we also accept that in a lot of occasions, it's just not so much because it was because them themselves decided to make certain choices. It also has to do a lot with media and how education, there was a lot of lack of, even today in many areas, lack of education curriculum, but climate change, the media did not take this seriously. Outreach was very poor. So when people like blame like previous generations for not taking action, that's not really the case. It's more complicated than that. So I want to say that because I know that sometimes youth organizations are seen as people who avoid older generations. And it's not quite like that. It's just that we're critical about past actions, past movements. And we do want them to be part of the movement. And how can they support? So first of all, there's several people who come, older generations that actually come to our meetings. Anyone is welcome to come to our meetings. I've seen people in their 50s, 60s, 70s, and also someone in their 80s who regularly comes to our HUF meetings. And that is one thing that you can do. Please do not think that you cannot be there or that you might be feel uncomfortable because most people are in college students or in high school. And we just want us to hear us and listen to us about how we were concerned about our futures, because the way things are looking now and maybe like 20 years, our lives could be significantly different depending on where we are in the country. And other things that we can do is that you can always be part as well of many of the events that we organize. For example, whether it is a protest or a march, or whether we have campaigns lobbying specific candidates, we can definitely also be part of that. And we're also always welcome to invite any other groups who might not be part of the youth climate activism to also join us on that. Other ways that I've also seen other people is through donations to help us keep going as nonprofits. And also we're also always welcome like criticism, talking about conversations about how to support each other. All of those things are things that anyone can do. So once again, please do not get this idea that you cannot come to our meetings or be part of this movement. There are many ways. It is just the fact that Sunrise emphasizes younger people because they are going to want to be the most affected by this, especially when this is not their fault. They didn't choose to be in this situation.
Yeah. I know too that, you know, the work that we do wouldn't be possible without the generations that came before us. So, you know, we build upon the work of so many others, and we're able to do what we do because of what's been done, and we're able to adapt and learn new ways as well. So going back a little bit to tactics, so you've touched, one listener asks, on what you've been asking for, but we have a question about how. Seven, can you speak more specifically about what adaptations in tactics youth activists have taken during COVID? And what is sort of working, what's sticking? Texting, virtual town halls, what isn't working?
Yes, so some of those tactics, for example, right now we have a campaign called Which Side Are You On? And what that was doing is, what it's doing is that we're trying to identify the representatives who are serious about passing climate policy at the state level, and like pushing this referendum to like get to see who is in our side and who's not. That also takes a lot of lobbying, a lot of outreach to them. And after this campaign is over, after seeing how representatives vote, we want to see who is in our side and who's not, so that we can take action in future elections, either to support them or not support them in coming elections. So that is something that has been working because that's obviously something that people can do from home. And a lot of people who want to be involved and feel like that they don't have the power at the moment, we are emphasizing those things that, yes, you can do this, and they can be very impactful because there's many people like you right now who want to do something, but just to feel like they don't have the power. So recently we have hundreds of people reaching out to the representatives, and we have seen some effectiveness recently. And something else that it's also working is having virtual town halls. So as I mentioned, we had about 80 people, typically in-person health meetings. We have just a little bit more, maybe about 100 around that, but that was still very close to that number. So that is inspiring considering it was the first one. And we plan to continue having these town halls to do check-ins, to talk about our campaigns and about how anyone who attends them can be part of them. Did I answer the question, Holly?
Yeah, I think that's a great answer. Yeah, it's been pretty incredible to watch, and everyone I'm sure can resonate with this, to watch how much going virtual has changed everything, and also, you know, in many ways has made it a lot easier for people to engage. So very interesting. Engage and get involved in the political process, which is always something that we love to see. So this is a question from a teacher. As a teacher, and this also goes back to your earlier point about curriculum and how that's evolved over the years. As a teacher, what do you think early and primary education institutions should be doing differently in regards to teaching about climate change and how it affects the students' future?
Yes. So the first thing that I want to say after talking to a lot of teachers and students that I that I've worked with older students, and also in my experience in grad school with other future teachers, is that the first challenge when that question comes up is that a lot of people think that that push is political. But I want to emphasize that environmental change, that is science. It's something that shouldn't be seen as partisan. That's the first emphasis that I want to say when I answer that question. Even back to myself, I will think to myself, am I pushing like an agenda or something like that? But I concluded that that's not the case. This is something that affects all people, all life on Earth, the future of our students, and those things shouldn't block me from taking action. And to answer the question more specifically, climate and environmental science, it's actually doesn't have to be so complicated as it is when we, for example, take it in college. For example, we can definitely talk to students about how some animals are, like, for example, like polar bears are being affected by that. We can also talk about how some actions that people are taking and are affecting other people, how that is causing more hurricanes, how that is increasing the temperatures. And although it sounds very simplistic, I think that's just the start of younger children realize that their actions have an effect on their planet, other people, and all life on Earth. So I think like building like some curriculum and science lessons on that, on seeing how there's like a cause and effect, and that is already taught, like for example, in English class, thinking about cause and effect can be connected in our science classes, even for younger children. That is, to be also honest, that's still a question that I think about, and a lot of other teachers are thinking about. So I will be happy to connect to the teacher that has a question, the other teachers to like think about how to like build a stronger curriculum. And something else that I just learned about like 2 weeks ago, about a month ago, another organization by the name of Massachusetts Educational, I'm sorry, I want to make sure I get it right. I will send the, I know like Casey's going to send later this information. Yeah, there's another organization who is connecting to other schools from Cape Cod, Western Mass, and also of course the Greater Boston area. And there's like students doing their own presentations about climate change. There's also a lot of push for change of curriculum. These students and teachers are also reaching out to, for example, to DESE, to state representatives, to think more about some of the curriculum that we have in our schools. Yeah.
That's great. I know that there's going to be some incredible material that comes out in the next couple of years. I just, sometimes I wonder, you know, what history textbooks are going to look like in 10 years and, you know, history, science, all of it. I love this question and I'm so curious to hear this myself, but one reader or one participant asked, what has been the most meaningful, impactful, or memorable moment for you in your time as an activist?
Yeah. Has been so many great moments and impactful and memorable moments in the past almost 10 years. But I think the most memorable one was when back in 2017, when DACA was being ended. I was very afraid, as many other people were as well. And I was nervous. And I just realized that I had to take action, that in difficult moments is where we really need to come out because we are representing so many people. We can't just let things be the way they are. And I decided to travel to DC, and I was in national television multiple times. I spoke to, I'm not kidding about this, close to 250 representatives combined of the Senate and the House in a range of just a month and a half. And it just made me realize that I can definitely do this, that something like talking to your senator, whether it was Ted Cruz or Bernie Sanders or Elizabeth Warren, is something that I can do. I have the power to do that, and that I can be the voice for a lot of people in difficult moments. And I think that just made me more resilient, as it has been for other people as well. And that is why today, I don't even think about it. Like, I know that more than ever, I have to continue being involved.
That's so inspiring to hear. You know, it's those moments when we really feel like we have a voice, I think, as activists, when we feel heard. I think that's very human of us. And I think that's sort of what we're all looking for. So we have a couple more minutes, and I think maybe time for one or two more questions. So let's see. I really like this one. Can you share a positive vision of the future with us? What does it look like when we win?
Yeah, so this is not just for me. I think I'm also quoting a lot of members of your organizations. We see a future in which climate change policy, climate change action is just common sense. That it is common sense that fossil industries putting millions into representatives and for them to be elected, that it is common sense that that is not okay. Because it's not for the best interest of all people. I also see a future in which our legislation is in schools or we're evidence-based, and also a future in which all people are properly protected and represented, regardless of where they come from, where they live, and what their status might be, whether it's their income, or any other type of status, that they are properly represented. And I think, I remember this quote that that says something like this, I do not like to be involved in the climate movement, because in the future, I want to live in a world where I don't need to be doing that. I kind of chip it out, but the point is that I want to live in a world where I don't have to be thinking so much about environmental change, where I know that my representatives are properly taking action on that, where they listen to science, and where I can live normally and just feel safe and not have to be so stressed out like many of us are all the time, telling people things that I think are just common sense to me. And that's why I emphasize the common sense component, that I want all the things that I'm saying and that a lot of us tuning in, that we know it's important, to just be something that we should all do, like something that should be in our government, in our communities, in our education, and the idea also of those people who represent us.
Thank you so much, Seven. This has been really wonderful for me to hear, and I know that this has been incredible for everyone listening in. And I just want to thank you for joining us today and for your inspiring work with youth climate movements. And I also want to thank all of you listeners for joining us. We've planned a really exciting 10-week series of webinars on many of the issues that we touched on today. So I'd just like to let you know to look out for an email from the ELM team with links to the recording of this session, which we encourage you to share out with your networks, and the registration information for next week's webinar with Massachusetts Attorney General Maura Healey. So with that, take care, try to stay positive, and we hope to see you next time.
Thank you.